biomarker and no possibility to identify patients patients early. In Tayside, you know, like we think that we have about 750 to 1,000 patients. All over Scotland, there will be about 10,000 patients with Parkinson's disease, and you know, and we don't really know what the underlying etiopathology of Parkinson's disease is. You know, like we are developing an understanding that there's probably a combination of different factors, like genetic factors, environment, and aging, which cause this syndrome. Most of the cases of Parkinson's disease is what we call sporadic or idiopathic, but you know, like we've known for the last 100 years that that there are familial occurrence of Parkinson's disease, and you know, like we think that the pathways that we can identify and extrapolate information from may be actually relevant for the idiopathic forms of the disease. As I said, it was first described 200 years ago. I think the accomplishment is really that there is somebody who discovered that patients who have different symptoms actually like can be combined into a syndrome. And I think like the first description was really only on 6 patients, which James Parkinson did not examine himself, but he just observed them. So I think like that's really like the accomplishment by him. And then like it is, as I already said, it is very, very common. It is the most common neurodegenerative movement disorder, and the second most common neurodegenerative disorder after Alzheimer's disease. The overall prevalence is about 1 in 1,000, but it goes down to quite a high number, 1 to 2% of elderly people in the UK. I already mentioned that there are about 10,000 people with Parkinson's disease in Scotland, and of those, we probably estimated 800 have Parkinson's disease with early onset. Early onset, there's a bit of controversy with regards to the definition. Very early onset is between the ages of 20 and 30. Early onset, below the age of 40, 45, but I think like there's a bit of flexibility. Then with regards to the timeline, you know, as I said, like the first description of the syndrome was in 1817. Then Louis discovered the inclusion, proteinaceous inclusion bodies that that are pathological hallmark of the disease in 1912. Then levodopa was introduced into clinical practice in 1967, and to date still represents the most potent medication in you know, like for treating of motor symptoms in Parkinson's disease. Then, like, you know, for last 20, 30 years, the brain stimulation has come into mainstream practice, and 1997 really is the hallmark that highlights the you know, like the era of the genetic discoveries in Parkinson's disease. Because up until then, despite acknowledging that there are familial occurrence of the disease, like, you know, it was believed that it was a disease that is caused by environmental factors. And like, you know, like I think, like, you know, look, there may still probably be genes that will be discovered in the near future, but you know, like from the first gene alpha synuclein in 1997 to now, like, you know, we have up to 30 loci and risk factors and a few clearly disease-causing genes that we've identified, and we believe that somehow, like, you know, like the pathways of these genes converge and will tell us a little bit more about the understanding of the function of the genes and what is actually implicated in Parkinson's disease. There are, what I've not mentioned is, like, you know, I mentioned dopamine, but there are also like dopamine replacement therapies, stem cell transplantations. And that is also, like, you know, like in the area or in the ballpoint figure over the last 30 years. It was pioneered in Sweden, where the people used dopaminergic neurons from fetal brains that, you know, like aborted fetuses, and implanted it in the midbrain. And the results of these very early transplantation studies were mixed, but partly encouraging. But you know, it's never really made its movement into mainstream practice. That has to do with ethical implications. It also has to do with the availability of, obviously, like, you know, like fetal brain tissue. And it may be like, and then it had quite a lot of hype and publicity, and also like a little bit of setbacks with probably false reports of unrealistic results from Mexico. And there may be now a new era coming for, you know, like with the availability of stem cells, where you can induce pluripotent stem cells to differentiate to dopaminergic neurons, and that will obviously give you the possibility of implanting, you know, like equal potency cells into patients. So there may be a future role for this, but obviously this is just replacing one of the neurotransmitters that is missing in the brain. And, you know, like as I said, like, you know, like with the understanding of the very intricate signaling cascades in the basal ganglia, the brain stimulation has really like refined and evolved, and the target is the subthalamic nucleus. Deep brain stimulation is a technique that is very, very successful, and is used in advanced Parkinson's disease, and it then allows like really like a dramatic reduction in levodopa medication, and usually like, you know, this it is aimed for people who have quite a lot of levodopa-induced side effects, such as dyskinesias, on and off periods, and deep brain stimulation then basically allows a setback with regards to medication, and patients can often do with just minimal levodopa replacement therapy or even none. At the moment, like, we really only have very few patients who undergo deep brain stimulation. That has to do with deep brain stimulation so far not being available in Scotland. At the moment, we have an arrangement with Newcastle, and we send patients to Newcastle. But obviously, these are older patients. These are quite debilitated patients. And traveling to Newcastle for aftercare is quite difficult. There are now developments, and I think like within this year, there will be a national DBS service in Glasgow, and that will be much, much, much better for our local patients. And still it leaves us with we are at a point where we have where so much has really like emerged and developed, but we have no disease modifying treatments, and we don't have any biomarkers. You will all be familiar with the motor symptoms: tremor, bradykinesia, rigidity, and postural instability. And there's usually like a little bit of underappreciation of non-motor symptoms. And these non-motor symptoms often occur much, much, much earlier than motor symptoms. So, and these include like sleep disorders, hallucinations, gastrointestinal dysfunction, depression, cognitive impairment, dementia, and also anosmia. Like, you know, if you ask patients who are just diagnosed or just emerged to have motor symptoms, if you ask them about, and what about your sense of smells, they often tell you like, oh, you know what, funny that you ask, but for the last 10, 15 years, I've not been really smelling that well. So you know, this is all quite important with regards to non-motor symptoms. So this shows a pathology specimen of a normal brain. So you can here see a section through the midbrain and the darker stain of the substantia nigra. And this is the same section through the brain of a Parkinson patient. And with age, there is neurodegeneration going on in every healthy adult, but this is accelerated in Parkinson patients. And as I pointed out before, like, you know, you really only have onset of motor symptoms at a point where quite a lot of dopaminergic neurons in the substantia nigra have already degenerated. And this is just like a microscopic image of Lewy body pathology. Here, light microscopy and electron microscopy. Then, you know, as a result of this, or bystanders, also like microglial activation in the substantia nigra and other parts of the brain. And all of this is basically the histopathological correlate of Parkinson's disease pathology. Then, This is a very, very important publication from Prague, from Frankfurt in Germany. So basically, he developed a model, a six-stage model of the emergence of Parkinson pathology in the brain. And when you look at this, these stages, you can see that the clinical threshold comes at a point, so motor symptoms as the clinical threshold comes at a point when there's already quite a lot of involvement. And what is quite interesting is that the first signs of Lewy body pathology and the loss of aminergic projections really is in the frontal region and also in the olfactory bulb. So this model really like helps you to develop an understanding and why or rationale for why non-motor symptoms occur prior to the prior to the evolving motor symptoms. What it also like, you know, what it also lends itself, and I'm not going to talk too much about alpha-synuclein, but you know, like there is a propagation of these Lewy body pathology, Lewy body inclusions, which consist of alpha-synuclein, through the brain. And like in recent years, there has been quite a lot of interest with regards to prion-like propagation of Parkinson's related pathology in the brain. So that's quite interesting. This is a very nice figure with regards to the clinical symptoms of non-motor symptoms and then motor symptoms with regards to timeline. As I said, like you can really only make the diagnosis once you have motor symptoms of Parkinson's disease, but like, you know, sometimes 10, 20 years back, you know, like you notice, you know, like a patient may have already reported constipation, and then like, you know, anosmia, sleep problems, and all of this, like the burden of the non-motor symptoms increases while new motor problems emerge. And then like, you know, like what is also often underappreciated is that, you know, like that it's not a selective, like, you know, not only a selective problem relating to motor problems, but, you know, like there is quite a lot of neuropsychiatric problems with regards to psychosis and also dementia. So it is really quite a nasty disease. With regards to non-motor features, what is also something that is really only like recently appreciated is that they also fluctuate. So when you have a patient with motor symptoms, like, you know, like we always ask, like, you know, how is your medication helping you with regards to your motor symptoms? Are you particularly stiff and stuck at times, or do you have abnormal movements? And you know, like patients tell you with relation to their last dose of dopamine replacement therapy what kind of symptoms they experience. And what is quite interesting is that when you ask them about non-motor symptoms, that these also like appear to fluctuate. And this may also be an explanation why people really, like, you know, you can almost see this dopamine craving that patients usually prefer to be in an on state, like in a hyperkinetic, dyskinetic state, and that probably also has to do with the fluctuation of non-motor symptoms. And I hope that I can show you the video of this gentleman who is, sorry, might have to go out of here, I'm trying to somehow get it into the,
not sleeping for 3-4 days at a time, which I thought was normal.
So this is a patient with young onset Parkinson's disease with actually like compound heterozygous mutations in the Parkin gene, and he developed dopamine dysregulation syndrome on, you know, increasing doses of rotigene, which is a dopamine agonist. And he basically, like, this is like a 1 or 2 minute movie where he describes his, you know, like his behavioral abnormalities, and that it was almost like an addictive behavior, like, you know, like so what we call dopamine dysregulation. So I'll...
Could you tell us about the other problem?
Not sleeping for 3-4 days at a time, which I thought was normal. Obsessive compulsiveness, having to clean floors 6-7 times a day, painting, things, the small things that you wouldn't think normally would annoy me, such as there was one thing that stuck in my head was the plug socket, the crack in the plug. I had to go and get it changed, and it was Sunday morning at 9:30, and I was up at B&Q getting plugs and stuff.
Okay, so you know, so this is quite like, you know, he actually had to be admitted into our hospital because, you know, into Nineveld, into our ward, because it was impossible to get him off the medication. And then, you know, as I said, like, you know, with regards to what do we know about the etiopathology of the disease, like, you know, we think that it is a combination out of a process of aging, environmental trigger factors, and susceptibility towards genetic factors. 1997 really, like, you know, like, highlighted, this is already, as I said, like, over 100 years ago, people recognized that there's a familial occurrence and clustering of the disease. But it was really only in 1997 that the first Parkinson's disease gene, alpha-synuclein, was discovered. And this is probably one of the tables that some of you may already be familiar with. But there is, like, you know, so there are quite a lot of loci and genes that have been linked and associated with Parkinson's disease, either as a risk factor or as a disease-causing gene. But we are moving away from this list of criteria. And in 2016, the new recommendations with regards to genetic nomenclature of movement disorders, and in particular Parkinson's disease, was published. I'm not going to go into too much detail here because I think that is probably not relevant to most of you here. This is, I think, like, probably one of the nicest figures explaining the genetic landscape of Parkinson's disease. So different types of genetic technologies and approaches have identified different types of genetic variability in the disease. So there are the highly penetrant and very rare causes of genetic Parkinson's disease, and then, like, you know, like, with you know, like, and then the very common but probably, like, you know, like, only low risk susceptibility genes, which have been identified by genome-wide association studies. And what I just want to point out, because I'm going to speak about LRRK2, LRRK2, a little bit later in more detail, you can see that LRRK2 is amongst the genes that causes autosomal dominant disease with high penetrance. It is a medium high risk factor, and variations in the LRRK2 gene cause, you know, like, increase your susceptibility to the disease. So this is really quite interesting because LRRK2 bridges genetic Parkinson disease syndromes and the sporadic disease, or what we call what is so called sporadic. Within the MRC protein phosphorylation unit, we are particularly interested in genes involved in protein phosphorylation and ubiquinolation. This is just like the nature of the unit, but also because phosphorylation and ubiquinolation are enzymatic reactions that are druggable. So, you know, there's quite a big potential for possible treatment interventions. And highlighted in orange, you can see all the Parkinson disease genes or associated Parkinson genes that have a link to either phosphorylation or ubiquinolation. So, for example, FBOX7 here. This is where I spent my 3 years of my life doing my PhD on. And I think, like, you know, in terms of, like, impact on people, I think, like, there are less than 20 people in this world with FBOX7 associated disease in only, like, maybe like 4 or 5 families. But I do believe that, like, dissecting these signaling pathways will tell us more about the etiopathology of the disease in general. When you look at, you know, like, what is clinically relevant with regards to Parkinson's disease in clinic, like, you know, like, it really boils down to only like a handful, like maybe 6 or 7 genes that are really, like, relevant in terms of numbers. So in terms of autosomal recessive Parkinson's disease, it's Parkin, PINK1, and DG1. The size of the letters represent, like, you know, like, the significance in terms of numbers. And then in autosomal dominant disease, it's LRRK2, and then a couple of other genes. And that is probably really relevant to patients. Although the movement disorder societies, they still, you know, they agree that in terms of, you know, clinical implications, genetic testing is not necessarily indicated because it doesn't really affect your treatment to date. I don't want to go, you know, like, I have a list of all the different causes, but I don't want to impose on this too much. You know, like, I mentioned that the Parkin gene is relevant for autosomal recessive young onset disease. To date, over 79 different Parkin mutations have been identified, and you know, it is the most common cause of of early onset disease. So if you have disease onset around the age between 20 and 30, you have a very, very high chance of having having disease because of Parkin mutations. And if you have a positive family history, you can estimate, you know, that probably like in 60, up to 60, 80% your chances of being Parkin positive or having Parkin-associated disease is quite high. And you know, like you will remember the video that I showed you, so this is one of our patients with compound heterozygous mutations in the Parkin gene. Usually they have an excellent response to, to a levodopa medication. And you know, like, so what they also often say is that their atypical levodopa induced dyskinesias, and what is also often part of the disease is that they report a little bit of foot dystonia. That is often the case in these early onset diseases. So then Ping Kwon, you will discover Miratul's name here. So he was amongst the people who have identified Pink 1 mutation as a cause of Parkinson's disease. Pink 1 is a kinase. And again, like the same as in Parkin, quite a lot of different variants and mutations have been identified. What is here on the top of the protein domains, these are the mutations and these are the variants where whether it is clear-cut pathogenic is in question. So most of the Pink 1 mutations are missense mutations, but they're also like copy number variations and rearrangements. It causes familial Parkinson's disease with early onset, but you might be able to identify Pink 1 mutations in 2 to 4% of sporadic cases. Again, more common so if there's young onset. And you know, like as with Parkin, it's usually slowly progressive and very well dopa, levodopa responsive. This is probably like, you know, this is a very, very rare cause of autosomal recessive young onset Parkinson's disease. I'm just gonna skip this. And then, like, you know, as I said, like, you know, like this is very, very important for several reasons. First of all, it was the first gene that was identified to be associated with autosomal dominant or hereditary Parkinson's disease. And then also like alpha-synuclein, proteinaceous proteinaceous substances are being are part and parcel of Lewy bodies. And, you know, it causes autosomal dominant disease. It can cause early to mid-age onset, and you know, like, so there are mutations in alpha-synuclein, but there are also like duplications, and if you have duplications or triplications of alpha-synuclein, the disease is more complex, more early onset, and not quite nasty. This is another gene that causes autosomal dominant disease, VSP35. That has been identified, you know, you can see like quite recently in 2011, and it's been identified in a Swiss and Austrian family, and it seems to cause tremor dominant Parkinson's disease. Again, like it's levodopa responsive, and age of onset is slightly younger than the sporadic Parkinson's disease, which usually comes on 65 plus years of age. Then this is another autosomal dominant gene that was identified in the same year in 2001. It causes late onset Parkinson's disease. It has a mild clinical course compared to idiopathic Parkinson's disease. But again, like, you know, the numbers identified to date are quite small. And overall, like, you know, you would probably not expect to find many of these patients in our Parkinson population. So another hallmark with regards to genetic discoveries in Parkinson's disease was the discovery of LRRK2 by two independent groups. So Andrew Singleton in the United States and then Thomas Gasser at the University of Tübingen. So basically, like, both were published, I think, yeah, you can see, like, you know, like back to back in Neuron in November 2000. And four, and this turns out to really like be the biggest genetic contributor to Parkinson's disease, and there are lots of different variants and mutations that have been identified to date in Parkinson's disease. It is quite a large protein. It has different domains, like most importantly, it has a kinase domain. A kinase domain is a biochemical domain that allows the phosphorylation of substances or proteins, other proteins, and then a GTPase domain and protein the actin domains. And what is quite interesting is so in terms of numbers, in terms of clear-cut pathogenicity, these are the genes that are relevant, and this one has the highest number. I have a couple of slides on this later as well. So it is really like quite common, and dependent on which population you look at, it is quite it rises in terms of its occurrence from a couple of percent to 30 and even 40%. Ashkenazi Jews, the Basque country in Spain, or in Berber region in North Africa. So it is really quite common. And since its discovery in 2004, more than 1,500 papers have been published, but we still have very, very little information of what LRRK2 actually does. We do know that it's a kinase, and I can tell you that like our lab, Professor Alessi, has been working over the last 10 years to identify the function of LRRK2. As I said, these are the pathogenic mutations that are clear-cut pathogenic, and the most common one is the G2019S mutation, and then other mutations as well. Although they are not all in the kinase domain, only these two, there seems to be an interplay between these domains, and all have an effect on the kinase function. Penetrance of this particular mutation, which is the most common one, is really age dependent. So if you are identified as having this particular mutation, you may actually live to the age of 80, and you may not develop Parkinson's disease. But the older you get, the higher is your chance of being affected by disease. And as I said, the importance about LRRK2 is it is very, very common, and it actually links familial and sporadic Parkinson's disease. Then, one other gene that I would like to mention is the glucocerebrosidase gene, and most of you will know this as the autosomal recessive cause for Gaucher's disease. And it was quite a sharp clinical observation by clinicians looking after patients with Gaucher's disease that there is a disproportionate occurrence of Parkinson's disease in affected individuals, but also in their families. So there's more and more research being done, and GBA mutations represent also like a very, very common risk factor for Parkinson's disease. So this is obviously Scotland, and I've already told you that we think that there are probably like 10,000 people with Parkinson's disease in this area. Of those, 800 with young onset. We are particularly interested here in young onset because it tells us that there's probably a little bit more of a genetic heritability etiology to these cases. And at the moment, genetic testing in all of Scotland is really only available in Dundee, and we are able to only look at the moment at the G2019S mutation in the LRRK2 gene and Parkin sequencing. And I will tell you a little bit how we are hoping to change this. Why is genetic testing important? It doesn't really, to this point in time, it doesn't really alter the management of your disease. But as soon as you're a little bit out of the box, if you're not 65 years old, you really want to know a little bit more about, is it really Parkinson's disease and what is it? So patients really do want to know, especially when they are from a large family, they want to know with regards to family planning and, to really, consolidate their diagnosis. This is also quite important, accurate diagnosis and classification. And in the future, not now, but in the future, it may inform treatment. And I do think that the future with regards to bringing clinical treatments with regards to disease modification into practice, you really need genetic information, and you need very, very, very detailed clinical phenotyping of patients because as you may have already seen with regards to age of onset and symptoms, Parkinson's disease is really only an umbrella term for quite a number of actually different diseases. So the clinical phenotyping and the genetic phenotyping will be quite important. So what we are hoping to establish with the help from genetics is that we are really like trying to establish a clinical Parkinson's disease exome panel where we are looking at quite a large number of genes. And at the moment, we are looking at the first 25 patients with the help of the genetics department and people in the laboratory. And if we are able to establish this, then we are hoping that this might be developed into a service that could be provided Scotland-wide. Then in the audience is Rachel, and Rachel did an audit with me at the beginning of the year, and basically looking at the culture of Parkinson's disease medication administration in patients who are being admitted to hospital. And this is in line with a campaign from Parkinson's Disease UK, get it on time, because it is really, really vital that patients with Parkinson's disease get their medication on time, every time. What you may be I think that's quite important for junior doctors. So there's quite intricate timing and dosing of Parkinson's medications, and somebody who has advanced disease, he may really it may make a difference whether he gets his medication 2 hours earlier or later. And what often happens when patients are being admitted acutely to hospital via A&E, and maybe they have a chest infection, urinary infection, they can't swallow, that that it's a bit forgotten and neglected that they still need their medications on time. So what Rachel did, she looked at over the course of 1 month, she looked at hospital admissions of Parkinson's patients across 3 sites: Ninemouth Hospital, the Royal Victoria Hospital, and Perth. At the moment we don't have an alert system, ideally what you would like is an email alert system as soon as a patient with Parkinson's disease is being admitted or comes through the door. But Rachel had to go to all the admission and receiving units, to the orthopedic wards, had to liaise with the Parkinson's disease specialist nurses, and most importantly with the pharmacists. And so basically this is how she got the data. And we looked at Parkinson's medication prescribing and also administration. And again, that's quite difficult because we don't have electronic prescribing and administration. So she had to really develop questionnaires and basically interrogate everybody who's possibly involved with medications and Parkinson's disease, from patient to family, pharmacists and nurses. And she looked, we have developed Parkinson's alert stickers with also the medication that should be avoided in Parkinson's disease, mainly with regards to the dopamine receptor blocking action. And she looked whether she checked whether these stickers were on the patient's notes, and whether and to make sure that none of these contraindicated medications were administered. And we've done this in the year before, in 2016, and there was clearly an improvement with regards to patients receiving their medication on time at the point of admission, and then also in comparison to later years. What was quite interesting, Rachel looked at the first 24 hours, and there seemed to be quite good adherence to the medication regime. But then subsequently during the rest of this day, things got a bit heavy. One of the problems is that administration of Parkinson's disease is often out with the usual truck rounds from the nurses. So there's a constant reminding, a constant re-education that patients should get the medication on time. What was quite good is that there was quite a high uptake on the application of the guide get it on time sticker, and 100% of compliance with regards to not prescribing any contraindicated medications. What I thought was also quite nice is Rachel looked, why are being people with Parkinson's disease admitted to hospital? So mainly with falls, that tells you that these people move towards the orthopedic ward. So maybe when we do our education programs with regards to get it on time prescribing of Parkinson's disease, we need to target the surgical specialties as well, and then obviously infection. And this was basically like, you know, this is a figure that Rachel produced, basically like on time with regards to INPLU on at the time of admission, within the first 24 hours post admission, and then like in during the subsequent stay of the hospital. So on time, late, and missed, and there was one who was not on who had Parkinson's disease but was not on medication, and Rachel produced fantastic recommendations. So obviously, like the training and the relevance of timely Parkinson's disease medication delivery is key. You know, like I do think that, you know, if we eventually get TAC care, we might be able to implicate an alert system. I've spoken to colleagues in Edinburgh, and they use TAC care, and they have this alert system where an email goes out to the Parkinson's disease specialist nurses as soon as a patient with Parkinson's disease is admitted. There's one region in Scotland who actually has electronic prescribing and dispensing, because it's quite difficult to somehow really like see when the medications are being given, and For people dealing with Parkinson patients, it's really quite important where to get help. The PD, our Parkinson's disease specialist nurses, pharmacists, or you can always call your friendly neurologist or members of the team from the Medicine for the Elderly department. And then, like, also, like, you know, we have a neurology website, and like, you know, you find it under websites, and then like information for clinicians, and there's a section on movement disorders, and we will update this. And I just want to make you aware that, you know, that there is information on management of Parkinson's in the acute setting in the hospital, and this is up to date, and you will find that on the neurology website, and probably even on other sites in hospital. In the last section, I hope you're not asleep as yet, I'll tell you a little bit about what I've been working on over the last year, where I basically decided to establish a translational bridge between the MRC protein phosphorylation unit and the movement disorder service here in the hospital. And my focus was on the LRRK2-mediated phosphorylation of RAB-GDPases. It sounds a little bit foreign, but I'll try to explain this. This is the slide you have already seen this before. Basically, like, you know, like, this is the LRRK2 gene, the pathogenic mutations, and I have already pointed out several times that LRRK2 links familial and sporadic disease, which is quite important for us. And you know, like, that all pathogenic mutations reside in this catalytic core of the protein. What, you know, like, so a kinase is a protein that so LRRK2 has one of the catalytic domains is a kinase which promotes the phosphorylation of target proteins, and this is like the state and the physiological neuronal function in normal people. And then, like, people who have mutations in LRRK2, such as the G2019S, they have an increase in the kinase activities. This is something that's been known for quite a while, and this results in a gain of function. But what we really didn't know, and this is subsequently to neuronal toxicity, but we didn't really know what the phosphorylation targets of LRRK2 were. And this was probably, with regards to LRRK2 research, was the holy grail for the last 10 years. And in 2016, Dario, in collaboration with international colleagues, published the first paper identifying the first bona fide LRRK2 substrate, phosphorylation substrate, by a very large, very elegant genetic phosphoproteomic approach. And basically, like, showing that LRRK2 phosphorylates RAB10, which is a RAB-GTPase protein, at a conserved site at threonine 73. What I thought, so this was in January last year, and I thought whether I could use this basic research finding as a suitable translation project into the human system. I was wondering, could it be used as a biomarker for LRRK2-associated Parkinson's disease? Could it provide an ability to monitor LRRK2 pathway activity in Parkinson's patients? And, you know, like, so LRRK2 inhibitors are in the preclinical phase of development. Could LRRK2-mediated RAP phosphorylation be used to assess efficacy and target engagement of administered LRRK2 inhibitors? And, you know, so, you know, as I said, like, in, like, so far for 10 years, it wasn't known what phosphorylation target LRRK2 targeted, and now we know that it's RAP-GTPases. There may be more, but this is really, like, as far as we go. When you look at what other people in the world do, they can assess LRRK2, they can look at LRRK2, they can look at autophosphorylation of LRRK2, but nobody is able to somehow really look at you know, the whole signaling cascade. We've developed in our lab phosphospecific RAP antibodies, and you can see that there's a bit of cross-reactivity. This is not so relevant, just bear with me. It's just like, you know, it's just for us, it's amazing to develop antibodies that specifically recognize the conserved phosphorylation site, and the fact that there's cross-reactivity between RAP10, RAP8, and so on really only shows that this particular residue is conserved. What we also know is that, so this is data now from different mutations from mouse cell lines, and I'm just showing you this because we're using here these phosphospecific RAP antibodies, and what you can see is that that RAP phosphorylation in different mutant cell lines is increased in comparison to the wild type, and you can see that that RAP phosphorylation completely disappears if you treat cells with a specific LRRK2 inhibitor called MLI2. And extrapolating from this, if you put this, you know, if you look at this in terms of effect on target phosphorylation, you can see that the particular mutation that I am interested in is the G2019S, results in the homozygous state in these mouse cell lines in 1.8 increase in the phosphorylation of RAPs. Other mutations, this is the Basque mutation that is quite common in the north of Spain, has even like a more potent effect on RAP phosphorylation. And this is just to somehow show you that this is specifically mediated by LRRK2. This is basically like a kinase dead form of mutation of the disease. And we first started, obviously, looking at this in healthy volunteers. You know, like most people who do biomarker research in Parkinson's disease, they look at peripheral blood mononuclear cells. And our initial findings was that the signal-to-noise ratio was quite bad. And here I basically like just looked at the expression atlas from the European Molecular Biology Lab in Heidelberg. And like, you know, like when you just look at this table, I was just wondering like which cell type would be the best to look at LRRK2, but also like at RAP GTPases. And basically that just told me that these are present in these cells. And also like another rationale for using neutrophils was that when you look at leukocytes, the white blood cells in the blood, you know, neutrophils are quite common, whereas peripheral blood mononuclear cells, the cell type that most biorepositories are using, is much less, and T lymphocytes don't even express LRRK2 at all. So that was my rationale for then, you know, after unsuccessfully testing quite a lot of different cell lines for then using neutrophils. It's a homogeneous cell population. It's quite frequent. And after doing quite elaborate isolation steps with dextran sedimentation and Fecal centrifugation gradient, you know, I then basically settled on a kit, which is quite expensive, but takes the isolation steps from 5 hours to 20 minutes, which is obviously quite nice. And like, you know, you can then check for the purity of your cell population by FACS analysis, and it's really quite a pure cell population. And this is just like basically what I'm doing. I'm taking blood like in like 20 milliliters. That takes a couple of minutes. Then, like, you know, I explained that I'm using a kit for neutrophil isolation. This maybe takes 20 to 30 minutes, which is a negative selection. It's really like completely easy and very straightforward. And then, like, you know, once I have the neutrophils isolated, I split my samples in two, treat them with the LRRK2 specific inhibitor and without, and then the cells are being lysed and stored at minus 80 degrees until further analysis. And This is just to somehow show you that my cell populations are really, really, really clean, with a purity of at least like over 97%, and we get quite a lot of cells out of this procedure from 20 milliliters. This is just to show you like one experiment where I looked at 12 volunteers from our lab in Perlo, and here you can see at the bottom, at the top, you can see like plus minus the LRRK2 inhibitor MLI2, and some may not be familiar with looking at these plots, but basically like these are the control plots looking at LRRK2, at total LRRK2, and you can see that actually the amount in each donor is quite the same. When you then look at the autophosphorylation side of LRRK2, you can see that this is also like quite equal amongst different individuals, and you can see that if you treat cells with the LRRK2 inhibitor of the kinase function, the autophosphorylation completely disappears. And these are our control plots. And then when you look into the RAP proteins, you can see that you have RAP phosphorylation, which disappears upon treatment with LRRK2 inhibitor. This plot looks quite ugly. I'm not going to go into too much detail on this. This was a technique that we used before. We had phosphospecific RAP antibodies available. This is basically like a technique called FOSTARC, which is really quite complicated. But we've moved on since then because we now have these antibodies. We then obviously if I want to somehow use this test in clinic, I needed to know is it possible to somehow let the blood stand for several hours? So we did a time course experiment where I basically took 150 milliliters of blood from a couple of donors and then started the procedure after 20 minutes, 2 hours, 4 hours, 8 hours, 12 hours, and 24 hours, and I just wanted to know whether my assay was robust. And again, here are the control plots, LRRK2, obviously the protein that we are interested in, the autophosphorylation, where the autophosphorylation disappears upon treatment with the specific LRRK2 inhibitor. And then, can I still detect, if I let my blood at room temperature stand for 24 hours, am I still able to somehow see robust phosphoRAP10 signal? And I do see that. And basically, this was the basis for us to somehow say, okay, we are ready to somehow take it into the patient. And for that, you may recall the slide that I showed you where with the first people who discovered LRRK2, Thomas Gasser in Tübingen. So I wrote an ethical proposal for Tübingen, and we went there in February, and we collected samples from 26 individuals, 7 with idiopathic Parkinson's disease, 6 people with LRRK2, the 2019S mutation, 1 carrier who did not have Parkinson's disease but a little bit reduced arm swing and anosmia but nothing else, and then 5 patients and 11 controls. And these controls were from a cohort study who had genetic testing and did not have any genetic abnormalities in any Parkinson's disease associated genes and had a normal neurological examination and also were quite healthy. And this was the slide for what I was here. So this is us in the lab in Tübingen, and this is my collaborator in Germany, and this was one of the patients, but it doesn't come out so well. So this is just a slide showing you the raw data. So this is what we are doing. We are doing lots of Western plots, and then using LICOR technique to quantify our results, and we express it as a ratio of different ratios. So phosphoRAP against GAPDH, phosphoRAP against total RAP10, and also phosphoRAP against total LRRK2. And you can express your data and your results in different ways. But what we do see is that when you look here at the group individuals in pink, you do see an increase there's a trend towards an increase RAP10 phosphorylation mediated by LRK2 in your patient group in comparison to the healthy controls. And there may also be a bit of increase RAP phosphorylation in the idiopathic Parkinson's disease group. Obviously, I'm really only talking about 6 patients here, but this is something that we are quite keen to develop further. I just want to mention that that RAPGBases may have, you know, like may actually also be a target for other Parkinson's disease gene. Pink 1, like Miratul Mukut works on Pink 1. Pink 1 has also been shown to target RAP as substrates, but at a different conserved phosphorylation site. Then, like recently in the last couple of years, RAP39B, another RAPGBase, has been associated with X-linked Parkinson's disease. And another RAPGBase has been identified as a risk factor. If you ask me what do RAPGBases do, they are, you know, like they are quite ubiquitous proteins that that are involved in trafficking. And you know, so basically, like, you know, like I just want to summarize that, like, genetic research in Parkinson's disease allows insight into clinical presentation, pathology, and pathogenesis. And you know, it's quite heterogeneous and complex. And you know, like we have very, very poor treatment options with regards to disease modification, and we have no biomarkers today. And you know, like I think, like, you know, that the LRRK2 mediated RAP phosphorylation presents a rationale for really, like, embarking on biomarker studies in patients. And I'm going to leave it here because I see that that it's quite late. I hope that I did not completely overload you with information, but I thought, like, you know, the last part of my study, I'm really quite involved there. I'm really quite amazed by what we've done so far, and I do think that it is something very, very interesting to take forward. Do you have any questions?